In this tutorial, I'm going to go through a number of vector functions that I will either be using later in this series or have found to be useful in my own projects. So let's go right to GameMaker. I've added three new functions to the main vector struct. The first function is negate. It, as you might guess, negates a vector. Mathematically speaking, this has the same effect negating a regular number does, and in code that's exactly what is happening. I'm just negating both components of the vector. To visualize this, simply imagine rotating a vector 180 degrees or flipping the vector. The next function I've added is getDirection. In the last tutorial, I added getMagnitude, and now we have getDirection. This function tells you what direction the vector is pointing in. To do this, I'm actually using the built-in GameMaker function pointDirection. You're probably familiar with this function. In fact, we're currently using this function in our ship's step event. It gives you the direction between two points, but if we just assume that one of these points is 0, 0, the origin point for a vector, then pointDirection actually tells us the direction the vector is pointing in. And by the way, you can do this with point distance as well. We could have written getMagnitude this way, point distance 0, 0, x, y, for the exact same reason. If one of the points is the origin of the vector and the other point is the end of the vector, then these two sets of points describe a vector. I chose to stick with the pure mathematical version though for point distance because it's a little faster than the actual point distance function, at least on the Windows VM. However, the pure mathematical version for point direction has a slight quirk. It, in case you're wondering, is darctan2y, x, and yes, the y is first. The pure mathematical version assumes that y increases as you go up, and it also returns negative angles. There's nothing wrong with this from a mathematical perspective, but it's not what the movement system we're working towards expects. So I stuck with point direction, which only returns a value of 0 to 360 and assumes that y increases as you go down. But this is something to keep in mind if you intend to use this system for other things. And with this function, you know everything you need to freely convert vectors from one form to another. If you want to go from length and direction to an ordered set of numbers, you use length their x and length their y. And if you want to go from an ordered set of numbers to a length and a direction, you can use either the built-in functions point distance and point direction, where the first point is 0, 0, or their corresponding mathematical counterparts. The third function I added is copy. This function takes a vector as an input and turns the struct calling this function into a copy of that vector. So if you said vector A dot copy vector B, vector A would become a copy of vector B. So these are the three functions I added to the vector struct itself, but it's not all that I added. The next thing I added were two structs, which both inherit from our primary vector class. And if you're unfamiliar with struct inheritance, there is a link in the top right to explain how it works. The first extension is vector 0. This function creates a vector where both components are 0. Technically, of course, you could just use the main vector function to do this, but I personally prefer this method. The next extension is vector random. This will create a vector with a random angle. You can set the length of this vector by passing in the length you want as an argument, but you don't need to. If you don't pass in any argument, then it will default to a length of 1 and create a unit vector with a random angle. Notice that we're using the length their x and y functions that we talked about in the last tutorial to turn a vector with a length and a direction into a vector represented by x and y components. Finally, I have added two functions which return new vectors. Remember that all of the vector functions inside of the vector struct operate directly on that vector. If you say vector A dot subtract vector B is subtracted from vector A and vector A is changed. If you say vector B dot copy vector B becomes a copy of vector A. Again, vector B is changed. This isn't always what you want. Sometimes you want to do these operations like copy or subtract on vectors without modifying the original vectors. And this is how you do that. So first I have vector copy. This takes a vector and copies it into a brand new vector and then returns that vector. So if you say vector B dot copy vector A, vector B needs to be an existing vector and it will be changed. But if you say vector B equals vector copy vector A, then the variable vector B will be assigned the value of this new vector, which is a copy of vector A that the function vector copy creates. Vector subtract does the same thing. It does the same vector subtraction operations that we talked about in the first tutorial, but it doesn't actually modify either of the original vectors. Instead, it creates a new third vector and returns that vector. If we look at the code, you can see that we're just taking two vectors, doing the subtraction directly, vector a.x minus vector b.x and vector a.y minus vector b.y, passing in those values to our vector create function and creating a new vector, then returning that new vector. So if you find yourself needing to do vector operations without changing the vectors that you're using to do those operations, this is how you would do that. So there you go, a bunch of new vector functions, and we'll be using a number of them in the next tutorial when we'll be creating our first official steering behaviors, seek and flee.